Welcome, 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 welcome to another week of online church. Come on, Rise Church family. We are so glad that you are on again with us. Thank you for joining in. If this is your very first time coming to hang out with the Rise Church family, we are thrilled that you are here. Come on, would you do me a favor right now and just in the comments, in the chat, however you're watching this, would you just write the words new? Just write N-E-W. And in doing so, what that's going to allow our family to do is to greet you, let you know how glad that you're a part of this with us. It's going to allow some of our staff to reach out with you and maybe get some information if you're willing to give it. But we really just want to say thank you so much for being here with us. Come on, can you believe that this is the 10th week that we have been doing church online? I'm still not used to it. I still don't like it. But I know that my God is still using it for His glory. I know that He is still working in your lives. So come on, wherever you are right now, crank that volume up and let's give our God some worship. Come on, we're going to sing about the victory that we have in Jesus. Let's go, church.
Come on, we sing. We see victory in our lives.
Formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. And I'm gonna sing a sing of victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna sing of victory, I'm gonna sing of victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord.
It belongs to
turn it for good.
Come on, we say,
There's a grace when the heart is under fire, another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. I'm always saying there was another in the fire. Standing next to me, there was another in the waters, holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire.
All my debt, come on.
All my debt left a dead beneath the water. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore.
It's true, come on.
Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I will bow to the things of this world. I know I will never be alone.
Come on.
There is another in the fire, standing next to me. There is another in the waters, holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding, my power set me free. There is a grave that holds no body. Now that power lives in me.
Come on.
There is another in the fire. Oh, there is another in the fire.
See it.
Oh, there is another in the fire.
You're with us, Lord. You're with us, Lord.
There is another in the fire. See the light in the darkness as the darkness bows to him. I can hear the roar in the heavens as the space between where's thin I can feel the ground shake beneath us as the prison walls cave in. And nothing stands between us. Nothing stands between us. Oh, nothing stands between us. Oh, Jesus. My church, we sing this. There's no other name but Jesus. There is no other name but the name that is Jesus. Yes. He who was and still is and will be through it all.
So come with me.
So come with me in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning. And I know I will never be alone. I believe it, Lord. I know I will never be alone. There'll be another in the fire standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters holding back the sea. So well, and should I ever need reminding, how good you've been to me. I count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. I can see, I can see the light in the darkness as the darkness bows to him. I can hear the roar in the heavens as the space between wears thin. I can feel the ground shake beneath us as the prison walls cave in. Nothing stands between. Nothing stands between. There'll be another in the fire standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding, how could you be to me? I count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. You sing that out. I count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. You sing. I count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. I count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. I count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. You with me?
Come on, church, we count joy in every battle. We know that God is with us. He doesn't leave us. Come on, even when we don't see it, we don't feel it. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. Never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop, you never stop
when
we
say.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, cause you are rainmaker, miracle worker, promise keeper. I'm in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Yes, you are, Lord.
You are a rainmaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, hiding in the darkness, my God, that is who you
are. Yes, you are, we say.
Yes, you are a rainmaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, hiding in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are, is our Lord,
a rainmaker. Miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Come on, church family, wherever you are right now, come on, wherever you are, come on, can you just give God a shout of praise in your living room, driving in your car? You better not be looking at your phone. You better be looking at the road. Wherever you are, come on, give God a shout of praise. We love you, Jesus. We thank you that you are everything that we need, that when we were lost, you came and you found us. And when our lives were a mess, that you didn't give up on us. You didn't wait for us to clean ourselves up. You came and you cleaned us up. You're the way maker, God. You're the miracle worker, the promise keeper, the light in the darkness. That is who you are. It's who you'll always be. Not just who you are, but who you are to us, God. We thank you for that. You're that and so much more. This is what I love about our God. He is sitting on the throne of heaven. He is sovereign over all, but yet he loves us and cares about us. And he can be anything for us that we need in any moment of our lives. And so whatever it is that you're needing, God is more than ready to be that for you, to show himself faithful to you in your life. And I don't know about you, but one more time, I think that's worthy of a shout of praise. So come on the count of three. If we all do it, it won't be weird. Come on, look to your neighbor right now and say, if you do it, I'll do it. Or tell them this, tell them, I'm going to do it. You better do it. If you're by yourself, just have a little conference call in your head right now. Say, we're all going to do it. Come on, give God some praise. We love you, God. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for never giving up on us. What an amazing God. That is who you are. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Hey, so wherever you're at right now, go ahead and get comfortable. Take a seat if you're not already sitting down and just settle in. I've got a word that God has put on my heart that I cannot wait to share with you today. Come on, I want to introduce myself. If maybe you are watching for the very first time, my name is Adam. I have the great privilege of being the lead pastor here at Rise Church. And let me just say one more time that if you are brand new to following Rise Church here online, go ahead and do us a favor and just write the word new in the comments or in the chat, however you're watching, just to let us know that you are brand new. We want to shower you with some love. Our people are going to jump all over you and just let you know how excited they are that you are joining us today. I'm so pumped to be able to bring the word. My wife got to share last week for Mother's Day, and man, she just brought the house down. Such a powerful word. I love hearing that girl teach, but today God has put a word on my heart, and I can't wait to share it with you today. We're wrapping up our series that we have been in for the past couple weeks, but before we get going, I want to just say this very quickly. A couple years ago, about a year and a half ago, actually, God really started burning this word family on my heart. Family, in relation to our Rise Church here, that he wanted us to become a family. Now, we have been a growing church since day one. And so we're not a small family where everybody knows each other's names. We're a pretty big family. But what I think God wanted to kind of speak to my heart was this, that as you grow, don't lose that family environment. And some of you, when you hear the word family, man, just your heart explodes with joy and gladness, because when it comes to your family, man, you got some of the greatest people surrounding you, your mom and your dad, they care about you. Maybe you got brothers, sisters, even your grandparents, aunts, uncles, whoever. They're just incredible people. For others of you, when I say the word family, it's not really a positive thing. It's more of a negative thing, because the people that should be your greatest supporters actually might be the ones that attack you the most. And what I mean when I say that we want to be a church that's a family is this. We want you to know that there is always a place for you here. We want you to know that you belong here. I don't care what your past is. I don't care what your present is. We want to let you know that we will welcome you in. So if you got some family members in your life that don't have your back, come on, that's what we want to be for you. We want to be your greatest encouragers. We want to push you forward and say, man, keep running after Jesus. And we are not going to kick you when you're down. We're not going to point at you when you mess up. We're going to come alongside you and go, come on, get back up. Let's do this together. We want to be a family. And that's what makes not being able to gather so hard, is because we're not able to be around our family. And so I know that you're hurting right now because you want to see your brothers and your sisters. You want to see your family members. But don't worry, the day is coming when we're going to gather again. And let me just go ahead and address this question one more time, because I know it's burning in your heart. It's burning in your minds. You're probably blowing up the chat with it right now. When are we going to gather again, Pastor? When are we coming back together as a church? And by now, you probably have seen other churches in our city that are gathering together. And I just need to explain it like this. Every church is different, and really every church that we've been following is taking a different approach to regathering together. Some churches are opening their doors up again, but they're not doing kids ministry. And if we tried that, we would excommunicate 65% of our church because we've got so many families here. Some churches are gathering, but they're only filling up their sanctuary area for about 25 to 30%. And I don't know about you, that just feels awkward to me. And I know that you might want to be in the room, and I know that you want to be together. And I just need you to understand this. As much as you want to be here, we want you here. And so we're working, we're talking, we're dreaming, we're praying, and we're asking God for wisdom. And so just trust me when I say that when we gather together again, we're going to gather like normal, just like what you've always seen if you've been through the doors of our church. Now, maybe some of you are new on this journey and you're like, I like this online thing. I think I want to come check you out in person. So you've been kind of dating us from a distance. Like, this is kind of like a blind date and you're just going to show up when we gather together. We cannot wait to meet you and give you a Rise Church welcome. We're huggers around here. If that ain't your thing, you better watch out. And so what we want to do is this. We want, when we come back together, for it to feel like Rise Church. We want it to feel like family. And so we're not going to rush it. So be patient. The day is coming, and it's going to be a sweet, sweet day. I promise you that. Hey, today we're wrapping up our series that we've been calling Who You Are, where the past couple weeks we've been looking at this song that we just sang, these four characteristics of God, that He is a way maker, a miracle worker, a promise keeper. And today we are wrapping up this series by talking about how our God is the light in the darkness. In 1879, Thomas Edison finally was able to patent the light bulb. Now, there were many other people that worked on the light bulb, but for Thomas Edison specifically, after 3,000 attempts, he was able to light up a light bulb with a sustained amount of light over a sustained amount of time, 13 and a half hours to be exact. And it's crazy to think that this little thing right here can light up a dark room. In John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus himself says these words, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness." Come on, somebody, that deserves an amen. "But will have the light of life." I know that some of you might be watching right now, and maybe you're not even sure why you're watching right now, because you don't believe in God and you wouldn't call yourself a follower of Jesus. But if I asked you this question, hey, do you think we live in a dark world? You would probably answer yes, even though you don't believe what we believe. And can I also just say, we're so glad that you're watching. It would be our hope today that you would hear about the love of God that wants to transform and change everything in your life if you want Him to. He's crazy about you. But everybody would agree that we live in a dark world. Turn on the news, whether it's our local news here in Jacksonville or global news. You watch it for a few minutes, and you're going to see about some darkness that is going on in our world. Can I share with you some not-so-encouraging news? It's only going to get darker until Jesus comes back. That's just the truth that we live in. But can I share with you some other really, really good news? Jesus came to shine His light into every area of darkness that's trying to come against us. And today, I just believe that God is going to shine His amazing light into every area of your life, every dark area that you're feeling right now, every hard area that you're going through. And God is going to bring you some hope and some encouragement today. Our world is dark because as people, we have darkness on the inside of us. We're all born with it. The Bible calls it sin. And because of our sin, we've rebelled against God. We've gone and we've done our own thing. And some of you are watching right now and you don't have a relationship with God. And you would probably confess your life is pretty dark. Maybe you don't think it is. Maybe you're kind of like, no, I'm all right. But some of you, you know what I'm talking about. Your life's pretty dark. And then for others of you that are watching right now, you are a follower of Jesus, but you remember, come on somebody, you remember how dark your life was. You remember the pit that you were stuck in. You remember the mess that you made of your life. And you also remember how Jesus stepped in and came and changed you when you couldn't change yourself. He came and he pulled you out of that pit that you could not get out of on your own. He came and he shined his light on your darkness. And now your life is completely different. For me, my story is very simple. At the age of 17, Jesus changed my life forever. Now, growing up, I was always a pretty good kid. I didn't get into a lot of trouble as a kid or even a teenager, not because of God, not because of Jesus, but because I was terrified of my father. Come on, somebody. I love you, Dad. You're amazing. But my dad, man, he didn't play games. And if I got into some trouble, he would take me out. And if you were to ask people that knew me, they would say, oh man, that Adam Peterson, man, he's a good kid. And the problem was I was a good kid, but I was not a godly kid, and I did not follow after Jesus. And at the age of 17, when everything should have been good in my life, I just wasn't happy. I call myself now, looking back, I was in a mild state of depression. And if you were to ask me this question, Pastor, did you feel like your life was surrounded by darkness? I would have said to you, no. But the problem I had, and maybe you have this as well, is that my life was surrounded by darkness and I didn't even know it. I was living in darkness and I wasn't even aware of it. And this mild state of depression hits. And as a 17-year-old, I should be happy and living my best life and enjoying everything there is that a 17-year-old can do. But I wasn't. And I can remember hitting my knees in my bedroom and just crying out to God one night, God, if you're real, would you show me there's got to be more to life than what I'm experiencing right now? And I can't explain it, church, to this day. I can go back to that moment, and I still can't wrap my mind around it. But in a moment, God showed me his love. And in a moment, God shined his light on my darkness, and all of my darkness was exposed. And I was able to see just the mess that I had made of my life. And in that moment, I heard the voice of God in my heart. Not out loud, that would have been awesome. But in my heart, I heard God say, and I still love you. I don't know if you've ever heard God speak those words to you. When your sin and your rebellion and your mess and your junk is just laid bare and you know that God sees it all. And he has shined his light and he has exposed the darkness in your life. But then he speaks these words, and I still love you. And I've got something so much better for you. Come on, that is a life-changing moment. And for me, I said back to God, God, if you love me in spite of all this, then I will follow you and I will surrender the rest of my life to you. And I have not looked back. It is the greatest journey that I could ever walk. And so many of you are on that same path. So many of you are following after Jesus. He has shined his light on you and he has changed everything in you. If you're watching right now and you have never let the light of Jesus shine on your darkness and expose your sin and reveal his love to you, come on, today is your day. In Genesis chapter 1, the very first verses in the Bible, Genesis chapter 1, starting in verse 2, it says this, now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. Now, I like to try to picture myself in those moments, and I like to try to think, how did that happen? Or in this case, how did God say it? Like, did he scream it out loud? Let there be light! Did he strain? Was it difficult for him? Let there be light? Or did he just say, get lit, somebody? What happened? We don't know. Or did God just simply say, was it not difficult for him at all? And this is probably the case. Yeah, let there be light. And as a result, light shows up, and God looks at the light and he says, oh, that's pretty good. I did pretty good on that. And the light of Jesus, just like here in Genesis chapter 1, is still shining his light on dark places and dark people and dark lives today. Now, I want you to remember that in Genesis right here, it says that the Spirit of God was hovering over the earth, that the earth was empty, the Bible says. And I'll say this to you, if you're watching right now and you don't have a relationship with Jesus, your life is empty. And just like the Spirit of God was hovering over the earth, the Spirit of God is hovering over your life, so desperately ready to shine the light of God into your life so that you could come into a relationship with God. I love my wife. She is my best friend in the whole world. Outside of her, my second best friend is my iPhone. Specifically, not just my iPhone, but the flashlight on my iPhone. Come on, somebody. When I got this phone and I got this flashlight, it was a game changer for me, because I can't tell you how many times I would walk in my dark house as a teenager, as a parent, and I would hit my toe or I would step on something and I would just scream. And I don't know what it is about the dark that just makes it hurt more. I could hit my toe during the middle of the day, and yeah, it hurts. But at the dark, man, it just hurts all the more. And I don't know about you, but when I hit my toe, man, there are words that come out of my mouth that should never come out of my mouth. Words that come out of my mouth that I don't ever say on any other occasion except for when I hit my toe in the middle of the night. Come on, somebody. And I don't know if you're anything like me, but I go down for the count, man. I hit that toe and I'm just like, oh, I'm writhing in pain and agony on the floor, screaming, Rebecca, I know it's broken. But it's not. I'm fine. It just hurt. But not anymore. Not anymore, because I got my iPhone flashlight and I don't leave home without it. And everywhere I go, I put my kids to bed, or I'm going to get some water in the middle of the night, or I hear a noise, I turn that flashlight on. You ain't stubbing my toe any longer, devil. Come on, somebody. I'm so grateful that the light of Jesus shines into our dark lives. And because of that, we don't have to trip over ourselves anymore. His word says that his word is a lamp unto our feet and a light into our path. Jesus said these words again in John chapter 12, verse 46. I have come into the world as a light, so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. Come on, somebody. That is good news for us. We don't have to stay stuck in the dark. Because of Jesus, he shined the light. We know the path to walk down, and we can trust him every step of the way. Jesus came to shine his light into our lives. He said that in John 8, but then he flips the script in Matthew chapter 5 in verse 14. He says this to us, to his followers, to this crowd of people. Hey, you are the light of the world. You are. I know I'm the main light, but I want to come into your life so you can shine my light through you, and now you're the light of the world. Because a town built up on a hill, man, it can't be hidden. Like, everybody's going to see it. You are the light of the world. If you've called upon Jesus to come into your life, his light now lives in you. And now you have been given the task, the greatest responsibility, these opportunities to shine the light of Jesus through you into a dark world. And I want to close my time today by just talking about three points today, three ways that we can shine our lives, three ways that we can be bright in a dark world. And I got a little creative and I had a lot of fun. I don't know if it's the quarantine that's hitting me, but I had a little bit of fun with these points. And so at first you're going to think he misspelled that or he mistyped it. No, these points are right. Point number one is this. You got to have the bright people in your life. Hey, it's more than just having the right people in your life. You got to have the bright people in your life. My life is so much better because of the bright people that I have surrounded myself with. They make me brighter. When you get around people that shine the light of Jesus, they bring out a greater light in you. And I'm so grateful for the friends and for the family members in my life that just continue to pull out the light of Jesus in me. If you surround yourself with people who aren't shining the light of Jesus, your light may begin to fade. Here's what I know. Light has the power to drive out darkness, but darkness has the power to drown out light. And that's why it's so important and so vital to your life personally to have not just the right people in your life, but to have the bright people in your life. I've seen so many people in our church who were spending time with the bright people, but then they got around the wrong people. And as a result of that, they became critical and they became negative. Come on, how many of you know somebody that when they walk into a room, they just light up the room? You know the type of people I'm talking about. Man, they just walk into a room and they are just electric. They bring so much energy. They bring so much positivity. They bring so much encouragement. Man, that's the type of person that I want to be. But on the flip side, you know the type of people that they light up a room when they walk out of it, right? Come on, somebody. Because they're so negative and they're so critical. Like, I don't have time for people like that in my life. And my prayer for you, my hope for you, is that you surround yourself with the bright people, that you yourself are shining the light of Jesus, that you are bright and you are letting it shine to a world who so desperately needs it. And that's why it's so important, even in this time when we can't gather together, that we've got to stay connected. We've got to keep just throwing another log on the fire, just saying, come on, let's keep shining our lights. Let's make each other brighter. Let's make each other better. Come on, we got to be that church. Come on, we got to have the bright people in our lives. Point number two is this. You got to do the bright thing. You got to do the bright thing. Notice again, I didn't say do the right thing. Because a relationship with God isn't always doing the right thing. It's not always just following a list of rules. Come on, a relationship with God is following after Jesus. See, I don't want to just have this religion where I follow X, Y, and Z. I want to have a relationship with God. I'm not just trying to be a good person. I'm trying to be a godly person. I want to pursue Jesus. I want Him to change my life from the inside out and so that I can shine my light and point others to God. I want to let them know about the hope, about the joy, about the love, and about the peace that is possible through Jesus Christ. And that only comes when I'm shining in my life, when I'm doing the bright thing. Come on, you got to do the bright thing. Some of you older people remember this. Motel 6 had a very popular commercial, little tagline that they would put at the end. The guy would say, I'm Tom Baudette, something like that. And then this was the line, and we'll leave the light on for you. Motel 6, come on somebody, we'll leave the light on for you. Come on, that should be the motto of the Church of Jesus Christ. Hey, we're here and we're gonna leave the light on for you. Yeah, you might be pursuing darkness right now. Yeah, you might be running away from God right now, but we're gonna continue to leave the light on for you. Why? Because we know what it's like. We've been down that path. We were where you are right now. And Jesus stepped in, and there was no other way that our lives were ever going to change unless Jesus stepped in. And He came in and He shined His light and changed us forever. So we're going to never stop leaving the light on for you. We remember where we've come from. So we're going to keep doing the bright thing. We're going to keep extending grace to people. We're going to keep telling people about the mercies of God that are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. God doesn't give up on people. Come on, he leaves the 99 sheep that are doing just fine to go after the one that is lost in that dark world. That is the call of God on our lives. We got to do the bright thing. Come on, somebody. Point number three is this. We got to have the bright attitude. Come on, I told you these were good. This is a little quarantine right here. We got to have the attitude of a servant, just like Jesus. Jesus didn't come to be served. Man, he came to serve others. He came to lay it down. I heard our outreach director say it best the other day. We're not waiting for people to come to us. We're taking the church to them. Come on, Momo, that was so good. What, in this season when we can't gather in a building, we're not just going to sit around and go, oh, can't wait till everybody can come back, man. That's going to be good. Oh, man, we just can't wait. We just can't wait. No, we ain't waiting for nothing, man. We're the church of Jesus Christ. You can't come to us. We're coming to you. And we've been doing that since we started. And we're not stopping now. Come on, God has put a mandate on our lives to go into the world, to shine the light of Jesus to so many people. And we do that through serving them. Because we're never more like Jesus than when we're serving people. So come on, we got opportunities. We want to have the bright attitude. We want to have the attitude of Jesus to serve one another. I know the Olympics got canceled this year, but one of my favorite part of the Olympics is when the runner with the torch is running and they pass the torch and kind of signals the opening ceremonies and everything's getting started. I love that. And they got the camera on this guy and he's just running and he passes it off and then a girl gets it and the next guy and then somebody else gets it and they're just running, carrying that torch. Come on, that is the call of God on our lives. We've got the torch of Jesus and we're just running it. Come on, we're running into a dark world. And when light shows up in darkness, guess what happens? Everything gets lit up and people can see clearly. And maybe for the first time ever, people start seeing, I need a relationship with that Jesus. I want a relationship with God. This is the call of God on our lives. Matthew 5, Jesus goes on to say, let your light shine into a dark world that they may see your good works and not give you an ounce of the credit. But when they see your good works, they're going to glorify your Father in heaven. Come on, this is what it's all about. This is why we're loving on one another. This is why we're coming up with creative ways to show each other love in this season so that when we love one another, a lost and dying world who's in a dark place looks on and go, man, those people, they really like each other. Man, that church, they're not able to gather, but they're coming up with crazy creative ways to show the love of God to each other. And when the people see that, their eyes are going to be immediately drawn to our Father God. And they're going to go, I want to be a part of that family. So come on, let's be bright. Let's shine bright. Let's shine it. I want to close on a little bit of a serious note, and because I know some of you are walking through some dark days right now, so let me just pause and just stop for a moment. Something hit home with me this past week when I got the news of another well-known pastor in our country that took his own life. And any time that I read something like that of anybody, but specifically a pastor, I can kind of in that moment put myself in their shoes. Not fully, because I'll never know what was going on in their heart and their mind and what darkness they were facing, but it just becomes real to me of like, this is spiritual. And the enemy is out to kill and steal and destroy, and there's darkness that is trying to attack people. I read this week, we're trying to flatten the curve of this virus, but there's other curves that are spiking up, and mental health is one of them right now. And if that's you that's going through some difficult stuff, you're battling some things in your mind right now, I need to tell you, don't give up. There is hope. Reach out to somebody. Don't hold that in. Some of you are walking in what I would call clouds of darkness right now. You go to bed and that cloud is just over you. You wake up and that cloud is just over you and you can't move on. And clouds of darkness bring frustration and clouds of darkness bring anger and sadness and despair. And I don't know how and I don't know when, but I believe with all of my heart that God can come and pierce the darkest of hearts and He can pierce the darkest of situations and the darkest of clouds and whatever it is that you're facing. And the light of Jesus can break forth and burst through those dark clouds. And when the light of Jesus shines, it brings hope, it brings joy, it brings purpose. So that is my prayer for you right now, that the light of Jesus would shine so brightly into your life, that your strength would be renewed, that your faith would be just reinvigorated, and that you would see God, that you would know He loves you, and that light would start to shine again in your heart. Come on, even when we don't see it, He's working. Even when we don't feel it, He's working. Come on, let's give Him some praise. Come on, church, lift your voices. Maybe you don't even need to sing right now. Just let the words of this song just sink into your heart. This is our God. He cares. He's moving. He's a light.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working.
Even when I don't see it, you work. Even when I don't feel it, you work. Never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you work. Even when I don't feel it, you work. You never stop working. You never stop working. We make miracle work, promise keep light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Yes, Lord, yes, you are. We make miracle work, promise keep light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Yes, that is who you are. That is who you are. Yes, that is who you are. That is who you are. Oh, that is who you are. Yes, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
It's who you'll always be, God. It's who you'll always be. To us, we thank you. We praise you. You're so good. You're so great. What a wonderful God. My prayer today is for you as if a follower of Jesus, that if you just feel like darkness is just surrounding you, that you would remember that the light of God lives in you and He will never leave you. My other prayer is that if you're listening and watching today and you're not a follower of Jesus, that today would be the day that you surrender everything to Him, that you let His light expose all of your junk, and then you hear these words, and I still love you. And if that's you, would you let us know? It's as simple as just saying, today, I'm saying yes to Jesus. Just drop it in the comments. Like literally just write it in. Today, I want Jesus in my life. One of our team members will talk to you, explain to you what it means to have a relationship with God. We want to know. We want to celebrate. The Bible says that all of heaven throws a party when one person comes to faith in Jesus. And we want to join that celebration. We want to join that party today. Come on, somebody. Hey, I want to say thank you to everybody that calls Rise Church home, that is still giving so generously of your finances. You are ridiculous. You're crazy. We have been blown away by your generosity, even in this difficult season. It has allowed us to continue to ramp up our outreach efforts and do even more. And so thank you, Rise Church, for trusting God. Thank you for investing in this house. The family of God is blessing other families in our community, in our city, and around the world. You are incredible. I love you from the bottom of my heart. Rebecca and I love you. Well, come on, today was a good day. Come on, if today was a good day, shout amen wherever you are. Drop it in the chat. Write amen. Shout yes. Just emojis everywhere. Come on, we love you guys so much, and we will see you next week. Bless you guys.